Hello friends and welcome. Today's subject is very serious and important for the whole world. And it is about the antibiotic resistance in day-to-day life. Let's understand what is this antibiotic resistance and why we should care about it. And what can be the right approach to resolve this issue. I request you to invest few minutes for the sake of humanity and watch this video till the end. And if you like this video, please subscribe to encourage me. Now without wasting time, let's come to the main point. What is this antibiotic resistance? Let's understand. We use antibiotics to kill bacteria whenever we get infected with it. But bacteria develop the ability to defend or modify themselves so that particular antibiotic cannot kill them anymore. And when this happens, we call it antibiotic resistant bacteria. Now the question arises, why should we care about it? Is it really serious? And if serious, how dangerous it is? And answer to this question is yes. We'll try to understand with an example. If you pick up a bacterial infection from someone else who has been infected by antibiotic resistance strain bacteria, now you too have an infection that may not respond to antibiotics. And without powerful antibiotics to destroy this bacteria, your health is at serious risk and life-threatening complications may result. And most important thing is, this antibiotic resistance is rising to a dangerously high level in all parts of the world, threatening our ability to treat common infectious diseases. We must know that more than 90,000 patients are dying due to antibiotic resistant infections every year. And because we travel more, have surgery abroad, resistance to antibiotics is spreading quickly across the world. Now you can imagine, if antibiotics can no longer kill bacteria, then simple infections such as inflammation of the bladder can be lethal. Next important thing is, antibiotic resistant bacteria are often more difficult to kill and more expensive to treat and can lead to longer hospital stays and higher medical costs. If no action taken urgently, surgeons cannot carry out routine operations. A lot of common surgical procedures and cancer chemotherapy will be virtually impossible. And there is a growing list of infections such as pneumonia, tuberculosis, gonorrhea, foodborne diseases like diarrhea are becoming harder and sometimes impossible to treat as antibiotics become less effective. Now the next question comes in mind. What is the reason for this antibiotic resistance? And first reason for growing resistance is overuse of antibiotics. The more antibiotics we use, faster the bacteria develop resistance. And we use a lot in agriculture, especially in animals, in hospitals, and also in our homes. It is observed that where antibiotics can be bought for human or animal use without a prescription, the emergence and spread of resistance is growing very fast. In many countries, without standard treatment guidelines, antibiotics are often overprescribed by health workers and veterinary physicians and overused by the public. And the fourth most important reason is infection in immunocompromised patients like HIV/AIDS patients or patients with autoimmune disease with immunosuppressant drugs. These patients get frequent opportunistic infections which are difficult to treat and one has to use heavy doses of antibiotics. And last reason is incomplete and infrequent use of these drugs. Many people don't complete the full course of antibiotics. Use it for 1 or 2 days and stop. This is another big reason for antibiotic resistance. Now the question arises, how to resolve this matter or issue. As every coin has two sides, in the same way, we have to consider both sides to reach the favorable outcome. We'll understand first side first. Only doctors cannot solve this issue alone. It's a community issue. Whole community must involve to resolve it. So first, we have to do is make people aware of the problem of antibiotic resistance. At this point of time, only few people really know about antibiotic resistance. Because without urgent action, we are heading for a post-antibiotic era in which common infections and minor injuries can once again will kill anybody. So the first action is limit your use of antibiotics for really serious reasons. We use antibiotics for trivial reasons like simple sore throat, which can be managed without any medicine. We have to change this irresponsible behavior. Use antibiotics in must-use cases. Second thing, and if prescribed, everyone should complete the full course of antibiotics. Then all countries must come up with quite stringent policies for antibiotics. In many places, you can even buy antibiotics over the counter without a prescription. We must have strong policies to limit this misuse of antibiotics. And fourth, most important thing is we have to find alternative to antibiotics. Finding new antibacterial substance in nature went well in the beginning, and that made it possible to develop new types of antibiotics whenever bacteria become resistant to the old type. But we have lost that race because we are unable to find new antibacterial substance recently. So there is urgent need to do extensive research for new substance. This is the first side of coin, which we can do about antibiotics. Now turn to the other sides, because any judgment cannot be passed without considering other side. When we think of other side, basically bacteria have all rights to develop resistance by the law of survival. They also have all rights to live. But using antibiotics, we are killing them, so they are developing, modifying themselves to live. We should be able to live with them without killing them by improving our immunity, reducing our sensitivity to those organisms. Like ahimsa parmo dharma means don't do harm to them, make ourselves so strong and they will do no harm to us. We will try to understand this approach with the mythological story of Lord Krishna. When Sri Krishna killed his mama Kans in Mathura, Jarasandha, father-in-law of Kans, became enraged. Because of Sri Krishna, his two daughters became widows. So to avenge, Jarasandha decided to kill Lord Krishna and the entire Yadav clan. He attacked Mathura and the Yadav 17 times. Every time Sri Krishna finished his all army and defeated him in the battle. But Sri Krishna was very sensitive towards his innocent devotees in Mathura. At last, to avoid unnecessary loss of life, Krishna moved his kingdom to Dwarka. Since Dwarka was an island city guarded heavily by Yadav army, Jarasandha was not able to invade Dwarka anymore. So the lesson by this story is, killing is not always a right solution. We should do something so that bacteria will not attack again by making our immune system strong. We must know that bacteria are always present in most of us, even though without causing any infection. In most people, Staphylococcus is present in their respiratory tract without causing any harm. E. coli is present in bowel without causing any harm. Our body carry lots of bacteria every time, everywhere. They are silent because of our strong immunity. And when this gets weakened, they grow more and cause infections. So the basic solution is to strengthen our immune system. And for this, new immunotherapies to deal with bacteria are under experiment, and still we don't know real success rate of it. We have to wait little longer for its confirmation. Now next question comes in mind. If we get sick with it, what should we do? So answer is, unless serious, best way is to use alternative medicines. Antibiotics are not effective against viral infections like common cold, flu, most sore throats, bronchitis, and many sinus and ear infections. And widespread use of antibiotics for these illnesses is an example of how overuse of antibiotics can promote the spread of antibiotic resistance. Using alternative medicine in this type of infections is better solution than using antibiotics for long term. There are very effective medicines available in Ayurveda or herbal medicines and in homeopathy which are much beneficial in these conditions. For example, Tulsi or Osmum Sanctum has strong antibacterial and antiviral properties which our ancestors used for many infections, but now we rarely use it in our day-to-day life. Another example is Justicia Adatoda, common name Adulsa, very effective in respiratory infections. It acts both as antibacterial and antiviral as well as a good expectorant, but we rarely use it now. Several such examples can be given. I am not expert in Ayurveda, so Ayurvedic doctor can tell you more about this, or you can watch many videos on YouTube. Many nice videos are available on it. They are well informative. Being a homeopath, I am advising homeopathic medicines because homeopathic medicines are safe and side effect free. Second thing, homeopathy can be good substitute for antibiotics in many infections. Homeopathy may not be best option for critical infections, but it is an effective alternative to antibiotics in many infections. For example, acute or chronic sinusitis, tonsillitis, bronchitis, pneumonia, otitis media, gastroenteritis, dysentery, and in urinary infections. Third thing, homeopathy may prove to be best treatment for viral infections. Viral infections such as common cold, influenza, measles, chickenpox, mumps, viral hepatitis, viral meningitis, etc. can be very well treated with homeopathy. We use antibiotics in these viral diseases just to prevent secondary infections, which further contribute in developing antibiotic resistance. Next important thing is, whenever any medical condition become chronic or recurrent, antibiotics lose their efficacy. For example, recurrent tonsillitis, recurrent otitis media, or recurrent urinary tract infections. In this type of conditions, homeopathy works effectively. And next thing is, homeopathy boosts our immune system in such a way that we will no longer susceptible to those organisms without killing them. Now, if anyone don't believe in homeopathy, it's okay. He or she can think of other mode of treatment like Ayurveda or Siddha medicine or any other mode of treatment. But be responsible in your attitude towards use of antibiotics. Do things which are good for the society. Whatever good for the society is always good for us. Be stress-free. Stress can affect the way your immune system works, including decreased immunity. Second thing, positive emotions and a healthy lifestyle may boost your immunity. Some research suggests that optimism can actually make our immune system work better. The happier or more positive you are, the more likely to be less stressed, which will help your immune system. So do regular exercise, yoga, meditation, and most important thing, avoid all bad habits like smoking to boost your immunity. By doing this, we can stay fit and healthy so that we may not catch infections. At last, if you like this video and agree with me, please subscribe to encourage me for my next video and hit bell icon for its notifications. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.